though once you get down the stairs, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, I'm great. Ready?
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
Thank you.
please be seated. And welcome to this celebration of love that has its source in God. As we come together today to celebrate Jeffrey and Rachel's love for one another, their commitment to one another, we remember how it was that Jesus graced a wedding in Galilee and brought, created abundant wine. And in that same gospel, Gospel of John, we hear the message of abundant life. Life is good. Our Creator is good. And you, it would seem, have been created for one another. So we celebrate your love together on this day. I ask you now, in the presence of your family, your friends, and the presence of God, to declare your intention to enter into union with one another by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you, Rachel, take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband, to live together in holy matrimony, and forsaking all others, be faithful to him as long as you both shall live?
I do.
And do you, Jeffrey, take this woman to be your lawfully wedded wife, to live together with her in holy matrimony, and forsaking all others, be faithful to her as long as you both shall live?
I do.
In your programs, you will find a declaration of intention followed by the response of family and friends. Please join with me. The marriage of Rachel and Jeff unites their families and creates a new one. They ask for your blessing. Will all of you, by God's grace, do everything in your power to uphold and care for these two persons in their marriage?
We will.
Short message as we come together at this time of celebration. I had the honor of working with Rachel and Jeffrey, actually meeting Jeff, online via Skype. So we know we're in a new age. It's the first couple I have ever counseled using Skype, but my husband preceded me, so he kind of showed me the way. Whether it comes to international negotiations or it comes to our relationship with persons in our workplace or our more intimate relationships in marriage, close friendships, and family, we cannot overstate the importance of communication. Oftentimes when we talk about business, we say, what is important? Location, 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 right? And when we talk about relationships, what we say is, it's communication, communication, communication. The great joy for me was working with the two of them, going through a premarital instrument, and discovering that they communicate very well. And have been doing so for a number of years, first as friends, and of course as now committed life partners, and in a few minutes as husband and wife. In the scripture, it is written in several places, do not let the sun go down on your anger. Matthew's gospel states, if you are at odds with your brother or your sister, and of course that can be anyone, right? That doesn't mean your literal brother or sister. But if you are at odds, and if you are in, as we would say today, bad space with someone in a relationship, then quickly resolve the differences between you, even before you would come to the altar and bring your offerings to God. In other words, settle disagreements and disputes as quickly as possible, or at least begin the process of addressing them. Now, you may not remember this, because I first met the bride when her family, when Jean and Carol and Rachel, that part of the family, all came together to Embry United Methodist Church. You had a Sunday school teacher at that time named Mrs. Griffiths. remember asking you with my own daughter one day, what did you learn in Sunday school? And you both said this. Mrs. Griffith says, don't go to bed with anger in your head. Don't go to bed with anger in your head. But you know, that's easier said than done. I know Jean at least will be familiar with the work of Virginia Satir and Murray Bowen, the pioneers in family systems therapy. And when I was in seminary, we were made to read a book called Family Making. And they talked about how easy it is to start gunny sacking things, you know, just storing things up and not bringing them up to talk about. There was one instance, and for some reason this sticks in my mind because it seems so ridiculous, that a couple had come, after many years of marriage, had come for counseling, and the husband was beside himself, and he finally said, and one more thing, will you stop making Brussels sprouts? You know I hate them. And to which his wife responded, I didn't know you hated Brussels sprouts. It all stemmed back to the fact that on their honeymoon, and she had cooked, she wanted to please him. She made Brussels sprouts, which were popular in her family, but not in his family. He wanted to please her, so he ate the Brussels sprouts. She assumed that meant he liked Brussels sprouts. So for years after, she made Brussels sprouts, and somehow they never, never communicated about that, but that's how extreme and how silly it can be. Another thing is that we can just develop fatigue. I know you're both working people, and I know your schedules are crazy, and it's just we're all too busy and too crazy, and there's a fatigue factor that sets in. That's why sometimes, and I know we talked about this, it's good maybe to let the sun set and to wait till the next morning when you're, or maybe the next Saturday morning when you're awake and you've got a fresh cup of coffee to talk something through, because later at night is not always the best time. And also, of course, some issues, and we're always going to have issues in our relationship, some issues take longer. They take time to work through. You wouldn't know anything about that, would you, Jeff? Sometimes things take years. So I don't know what works for you two, but I have a... Who just got that? I have a cousin, she and her husband, even if they've had a fight, what they do is they hook pinkies, you know? They reach over in bed or wherever they happen to be, and they hook pinkies, which is a way of saying, we still love each other, we're still together, I know we're not finished with this, we haven't resolved it all yet. But that's their way of saying, you know, we'll work this out, we'll continue with this. I am confident about the two of you communicating. And I've got to just share a little bit of, just a little bit from your premarital instrument. Both of these young people came out as very, and I did share a little bit of this with your mom and dad last night. I guess it was my second glass of wine. But I didn't share anything too confidential. Both of these young people scored very, very high, above 90% in terms of self-confidence and self-esteem. That is very good news. They both scored very, very high in terms of their willingness to communicate and discuss things rather than shove things under the rug. And you know, I said, look at these scores. This is astounding. I don't think I've ever seen, you know, a couple with two scores, both in the 90s, where they're both really self-confident, assertive, and you know they're going to speak their minds. They're going to speak the truth and love to one another. So I immediately went to see what the distortion factor is, because these instruments measure whether or not you're distorting your answers to please your partner and saying what you think you should be saying. Your father shaking his head. No distortion. They really are that open and that honest with one another. So, and the other thing is, we were talking about, and we're going to see a slideshow, I guess, upstairs that shows, you know, a bit of the history, your personal histories together, and the parallels in your history. Well, in this premarital instrument, and I won't let on to anything else, I promise, after this premarital instrument, I said, this is so boring, because they agree about everything, you know? And I was trying to get a little wedge issue in there, you know, between, they either said, agree or strongly agree, disagree or strongly disagree. We didn't have any strongly agrees or strongly disagrees. We didn't have any undecideds. We didn't have any questions where neither of them had an opinion. But they always seem to agree. And I said, well, maybe I can get in between this strongly disagree and see if there's anything of substance there. But again, for me, it is rare to see a couple that is so harmonious and where there are so many parallels in their thinking and their opinions and their approach to life. So you got an A+ on the tree. I pray, as we all do today, that God will grant you the grace, the patience, the ongoing love to continue to address any and all issues life may bring to you, so that whatever you face, you will continue to face things together honestly, openly, respectfully, and in as so far as possible before letting the sun go down. So if there's anything really pressing on your hearts, you have a few more minutes if you need a heart-to-heart conversation before the vows. Yeah, thank you. All right. Jeff and Rachel have written letters to one another, being as uncommunicative as they are, they had to put something of their own in writing. So please, let us hear your writings to each other.
I want to start off by simply saying thank you. Thank you for always believing in us. Thank you for never giving up. Thank you for being patient. And thank you for helping me to see that we were truly meant to be together. Growing up, my parents always told me to marry my best friend. This, they said, was the secret to a happy and successful marriage. I never fully understood how important this piece of advice was until I fell in love with my best friend. I feel so blessed that we found each other, and I get to spend the rest of my life falling more in love with you every day. You are truly my other half, my partner, my soulmate. So on this, our wedding day, I make these promises to you. I promise to always laugh with you, sometimes at you. Never go to bed angry. To comfort you in times of sorrow, including rough Florida State Black Hawks beat and Dolphins. To always listen to what you have to say, and to remember that I'm not always right. I promise to encourage you and inspire you, and to truly love you through the good times and the bad. But most of all, I promise to be your partner in life, to grow old with you, to love you more every day, and to always be your best friend. I love you on reason.
Amen.
I know it's cliche, but the first time I saw you, I knew there was something special about you. I couldn't explain it. I just knew. If you told me 5 years ago that I'd be standing here about to marry you, there is no way I would have believed you. I remember the first time I stole you from Stroop's room when you were supposed to go get ice cream with him so that you could hang out with me instead. He was mad originally, but I think he's okay now. The more I got to know you, the more time I spent with you, the more the feeling that we were meant for something stronger in life became more apparent. We grew apart a few times over the years, but we always found our way back to each other no matter what. I can't see myself with anyone else. I never could, because everyone else always had one big problem. They weren't you. There's always been something between us. We just click. It's so easy to talk to you about anything. 3 hours feels like 3 minutes, especially the night before an English exam. I just can't say goodnight. Even when we don't agree on something, we can put it behind us and still get along. You even called me after Florida State suffered a crushing loss to Miami on the last play just to see if I was okay. As a Gator fan, that says something. We may not agree on everything, but that just makes us stronger as a couple. I promise never to judge you, to remain faithful to you, to support you in everything that you do, and to love you until the stars turn cold, and forever after that. You're my best friend in life, you always have been, and today I get to call you my wife. I love you.
Jeffrey.
Take you,
Rachel.
As my lawfully
wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward. For better, for worse.
For richer,
for poorer.
In
sickness and in health.
Until we are parted by death.
This is my solemn vow. Father,
Son,
and
Son. I'm Rachel.
Thank you, Jeffrey.
That's my love. To have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health, until we are parted by death.
Let us pray. These rings are an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace, representing to us the love between God and the church, between God and all God's people, and particularly on this day, between Rachel and Jeffrey. We bless these rings, even as we bless them as they come. All God's people said. My friends, now that Jeffrey and Rachel have given their vows to one another, have exchanged rings, I declare to you that they are indeed husband and wife. Those whom God has joined together, let no one separate. If you go, well, who should we follow here? We follow the bridal party. I have the pleasure now of introducing to you Mr. and Mrs. Jeffrey Jensen.
How'd you do?
Better for worse,
you are too.
If you are part of the family, please stay behind for pictures. Otherwise, you can head on up to the cocktail hour. If you are family, please stay behind for pictures. Thank you.
I was like, I could tell that I was on video.